What's up, everyone? Today we were supposed to be regaling you with the part one video of Joe's epic Threadripper build with the 7970X CPU and lots of stuff. However, we've had to delay that just slightly, ever so slightly, but that's okay. It gives us just enough time to slip in another probing.
Excellent!
Today's video is brought to you by the Enermax Revolution DFX power supplies, which feature a trifecta of good PSU things. Premium Enermax build quality with industrial grade 105C capacitors for gold rated efficiency, full modularity with plenty of sleek black cables, and a compact 140mm length. And their ATX 3.0 and PCIe 5.0 ready with a native 12VH power connector, have self-cleaning fans with semi-fanless mode, and are available in 850, 1050, and 1200 watt versions. And yes, RGB2, which you can turn off. For more on Enermax Revolution DFX PSUs, click the sponsor link in the video description. That's right, this is Probing Paul, my monthly Q&A, and I kind of skipped it for November, sorry about that, things were busy. And so we're catching up with December's installment, and as a bit of a Christmas gift to myself, I have selected softball questions that I can answer for you guys today. If you would like to ask me a question for the next probing though, check out the Probing Paul playlist where it has the history of times I have been probed, and of course comments for the next probing should be entered in the comment section down below. We will also be supplementing today's video with a bit of mail time because I had a package come in from my merch guy John. I am already wearing one of the hoodies, new hoodie design, check it out at paulshardware.net. That stuff will be coming a little bit later in this episode. But let's get started with the first question. The first question is usually the question that probes the deepest. And this time, it's coming from Joe. Joe said he had an important question to ask. What was it, Joe?
The thing you told me to ask you, no, just kidding. What was it? What are your predictions?
This is very natural. You don't remember what your question was?
What is your prediction for 2024? Is that it?
What are my predictions for 2024? What an insightful question, Joe. What a great question to ask. I happen to have written them down on this little post-it note. So I'm going to stick to the overall predictions for the big hardware, which is going to be CPUs and GPUs, which involves Intel, AMD, and NVIDIA. According to my highly tuned powers of prognostication, I think that come January at CES, we're gonna see the announcements and subsequent launch sometime a month or so after of the RTX 40 Super Series of graphics cards from NVIDIA. These have been rumored for a while. We all know they're coming down the pipeline. Haven't been absolutely confirmed yet, but it's pretty assured at this point based on all the rumors and stuff that have been coming out. It's a refresh. We're gonna get some GPUs that slot in between the existing RTX 4080 and RTX 4070, for example. They're gonna be calling them Super again, which I'm kind of meh about in terms of the name. And honestly, we don't have high hopes that these are gonna be like really competitively priced because that hasn't exactly been NVIDIA's strong point recently. That said, there's still gonna be some new cards on the market to test and try out, and hopefully there'll be something that offers somewhat of a reasonable bang for the buck. We'll see. We can also say pretty assuredly that Intel will be launching the rest of their 14th gen CPUs come CES in January. They've already announced like the 14900K, the K SKUs 14900, 14700, and whatever the other one was. It's just gonna be the rest of the 14th gen, so there will be more options there. I don't think it's all that exciting, but maybe there'll be some budget darlings down there that come out. And I think that's probably all the big announcements we're gonna hear about at CES. The follow-up to that is gonna be Computex, which happens mid-year at the beginning of June, and I am reasonably certain at this point, although I can't verify for sure, I don't have any actual solid data, that AMD will be launching the next generation of Ryzen CPUs, the 8000 series, to follow up the Ryzen 7000 series on the AM5 platform by mid to late year, which usually means a Computex announcement with a launch shortly thereafter, or we might see a teaser at Computex with some early information, and they might push the launch to later in the year, closer to end of Q3 or beginning of Q4 to try to take advantage of the holiday rush. Either way, for any early adopters of AM5, it is kind of nice to know that we are expecting another family of CPUs to launch on that platform, and we're expecting another performance bump as we have seen in the past. The big question mark that I can't really pinpoint in my mind, because I haven't heard too many rumors about it, is AMD's Radeon 8000 series of graphics cards. That's still a big mystery to me, and I can't say that I have any solid idea of when the Radeon 8000 series will be coming to market. That said, AMD has made some pretty strong strides with the Radeon Radeon 7000 series of graphics cards. So we are looking forward to those coming to market because that's going to be the biggest thing to pressure NVIDIA to keep their prices down and keep prices overall competitive in the GPU space, which has recovered a lot. If you're comparing to like a year or two ago, it's a lot easier to find a sensible graphics card. Even if you're looking at the more overpriced NVIDIA options out there, at least we're not looking at like a shortage situation across the board. Beyond those summertime announcements, I think Intel will have a 15th gen that's coming to market as well. That's going to be either 15th gen or their core series. I'm not exactly sure how they're going to name it. That's going to be on the new platform, LGA 1851. And I anticipate we're looking at a Q4 launch for that. Similar to the Q4 launch we saw with 14th gen, usually they try to push it out around the October-ish timeframe, possibly a little bit later than that, but they usually do, again, those K SKUs, those sort of Halo tier SKUs at the end of the year to get some sales out for those, and then followed up as they did this year with the rest of them at the beginning of 2025. And then the last big question mark is going to be NVIDIA's next gen graphics cards, the RTX 50 series. We've had some rumors swirling around about those here and there. Nothing too solid as far as availability or launch date. I would say optimistically, we're looking at a Q4 launch, again, trying to hit the holiday rush as lots of companies try to do. But I could also easily see NVIDIA just sticking with the RTX 40 series and RTX 40 super cards that they have out right now through the end of 2024 and us not seeing an RTX 50 series until 2025. Beyond those specific launch timeframe predictions, I would say the other prediction I have for 2024 is going to be a bit of a battle for fab space and fab time between the products that we like as PC gamers, your GPUs and your CPUs and GPUs in particular, and the other things that are being fabricated on those same nodes, specifically chips designed for AI. Businesses are gonna business, they're gonna put their eggs in the basket that they feel is gonna return them the most cash in return for the sale of those eggs, using a loose metaphor for GPUs. So what I'm gonna be looking out for is the AI chips getting preference on the fabs and the GPU availability getting a little bit less optimal, and possibly even the GPUs being held back a generation with the bleeding edge nodes all pushing out AI chips while GPUs just get a refresh with the current nodes. But a very excellent question, Joe. Thank you so much for that one. Moving on, we have another question from RS Panther. Would it be of benefit to upgrade a 5800X 3D from 16 gigs of RAM to 32 gigs of RAM? How important are RAM timings with the 5800X 3D, and would looser timings be better than tighter ones? So first of all, a RAM upgrade is a huge upgrade. It's a very nice upgrade. I would monitor my system usage. If you keep your system monitor up there and just see if you're actually getting close to using up all 16 gigs of your RAM, especially while you're multitasking, doing stuff like gaming and browsing the internet at the same time. If you're actually using up your 16 gigs, or even if you're getting to 12, 13, 14 gigs of usage, then upgrading to 32 gigs is definitely going to improve your computing experience. The one thing I would say for AMD's Ryzen platform in particular is if you upgrade to 32 gigs, rather than getting an additional 16 gig kit so you have four sticks altogether, I would say pull out your existing 16 gig kit and get a 2x16 gig kit so you're still just running a two stick configuration. That will be the easiest to set up with a Ryzen CPU and make sure you're running at your proper speeds. How important are RAM timings? They're fairly important. You definitely want to at least plug in the XMP values for your memory. Getting into the secondary and tertiary timings of RAM can get you a little bit more performance. However, it can also lead to instability, and if you're not really familiar with messing around with RAM timings, that can be a bit of a difficult thing to get past. Next question from Wrist9. Paul, maybe you've already answered this and I've missed it, but what is the meaning of life and all things? Keep doing what you do. The meaning of life is you're here to love and be loved. And if anyone tries to tell you otherwise, or if anyone tries to prevent you from doing that, or if anyone tries to put a damper on your ability to just like be positive enough to love people and allow people to love you, fuck those people. I hate them. Next question from Darth Snowman.
That's a cool name, actually.
That is a cool name. I asked this question back in episode 40 and thought it would be interesting to revisit 4 years later. Do you think NVMe is necessary? And I believe you mean NVMe SSDs. If you're building a computer, do you absolutely need an NVMe SSD? I would say no, actually. You can get by without one. Practically speaking, you at least need an SSD though. The biggest noticeable difference in day-to-day PC usage that is affected by your storage is going to be the jump from a mechanical hard drive to a solid-state drive, because the responsiveness is just that much faster. You don't have to wait for a drive read-write head to position itself over the proper place on a spinning platter in order to access that data. And most of that jump can be accomplished with a 2.5 inch SATA SSD. These are still gonna max out at about 500 to 550 megabytes per second reads and writes. So if you're building a gaming PC, you're gonna have good responsiveness. You might have a little bit longer wait times if you're like loading up a big game, for example, but in terms of actual like gameplay and stuff for gaming, it's not gonna be any difference at all. That said, while you can get by functionally with a 2.5 inch SATA SSD, my question would be, why not just go NVMe, because the prices on these drives have come down so far that they're pretty much in parity with the SATA devices that are still on the market. So if you're a budget builder and you're trying to shave off dollars wherever you can, sure, take a look at like a 1 terabyte or a 2 terabyte SATA 2.5 inch drive and see what the prices are, but don't forget to cross compare with even the low end NVMe SSDs that are out there, because they will typically more than triple your read and write speeds from a SATA SSD simply because they have more bandwidth. And if the price difference is negligible, then yeah, absolutely go with the NVMe. But thank you for your question and for following up after 4 years. Next question from Tony Landman. Paul, I think I speak for everyone here that it's high time for another seasonal pie video. Tony Landman, I was gonna say, I'm sorry, I already baked my pies this season and you can't have one, but you know what? I'm gonna share a little bit of photo and video with you right now because I did make some pumpkin pies from scratch actually just a few days ago. Not just from like the canned pumpkin pie mix, I actually roasted the pumpkins, scooped out the inside, pureed them. My daughter Hannah helped me. They turned out beautifully. And in fact, Joe's here and he's tried it as well. Joe, good pumpkin pie?
I approve.
Joe approves. Pumpkin pie, it's yummy. And there's your seasonal entry for Paul's pies. Sorry we couldn't give you a cream pie this time around. What, Joe?
Gross.
Isn't that gross? And the final question for today, a bit of a two-parter. Point Vector 1951 says, you're going to love the M.2 toaster. Oh my gosh, it's such a time saver. Absolutely, yes. In fact, I've already been using it and I already love it. What a useful little device just to be able to take an external M.2 drive, pop it in, access it to copy data or to blank it out or whatever you want to do on it. And I like the fact that it's got a SATA adapter on there as well. That's also very convenient. I covered this about a month and a half ago when we did the last Probing Paul, talking about SSD prices. Unfortunately, SSD prices have been on the upswing since then due to market forces and stuff like that. But if you're interested, I will once again post a link to this and some of the other SATA devices that I checked out during the last one. And then a follow-up by OG Mangler, who says, watch for the cables that come with USB M.2 enclosures. They bought a Sabrent M.2 one and the cable was bad. So absolutely double check. If you're getting external USB adapters for NVMe SSD drives, make sure that you're getting the proper throughput as advertised. And also, if you aren't, or if you're feeling like something's not quite right, the cable can potentially be the culprit, and that's been called out by several people. So good advice. Thanks to you guys for those follow-ups. And look, it even lights up the RGB. Cool. Of course, Probing Paul is often paired ever so intimately with mail time, and that is what we're gonna be sharing with you next. We had a package arrive from my merch guy, John. You can buy all this stuff at paulshardware.net, which is linked in the description. So let's check out what arrived. To supplement today's video, we have a bit of mail time, and this mail time I wanted to do with the big unboxing I did like a week or two ago, but it didn't arrive yet. This came from my merch guy, John. My store, paulshardware.net, sell merchandise, shirts, mugs, pint glasses, lots of cool stuff like that. And I'm somewhat embarrassed that Joe, my editor, right over here, who's also joining us today, doesn't have any of my merch. He's been editing my videos for so long, and I've been like, Joe, I'm gonna get you a shirt, I'm gonna get you some stuff, it's gonna be cool. So today, finally, once again, making good on a promise I made a really long time ago. So we're gonna do a quick unboxing, show you guys some of the merch, some of it's stuff that's been out for a while, some of it is a few new things, and let's see what we got here. Oh, starting with glassware, which I should be careful with. How nicely packaged the Paul's Hardware merch is.
Can I get it?
I'm not completely sure where we should begin here, so I'm just gonna start with what's in front of me. These are Paul's Hardware water bottles, which we've had in the store for some time. They're made by Arctic, and they're really nice. I have had one that I've been using for an extensive period of time. They keep your water oh so cold, or whatever liquid you have in there, or warm. It works for warm stuff too. Flip cap on the top. These are real nice, very sturdy, and of course, they feature the iconic thumbscrew logo.
They actually work very well. Yeah, they do keep like the ice frozen for like a long time.
And see, Joe doesn't like do puffed up marketing stuff like I do, so you know he's telling the truth.
The girlfriend stole it, so.
Your girlfriend, oh, see, even more endorsed not just by Joe, but also by Joe's girlfriend. We also have fabulous Paul's Hardware pint glasses. Now these are better than pint glasses because as you can see, they have a bulge there. The bulge allows you to put more liquid in it. So this is an imperial pint glass, which is 20 ounces, 4 bonus ounces over what you get with the stupid, crappy regular pint glass. A few of these things here are gonna be some Christmas presents for some friends and family. We do have some stuff specifically for Joe. Also following up on something for like a year or two ago, Adrian, who's a longtime follower of the channel, had a pint glass or a set or something like that, and he accidentally broke it. And I told him like 2 years ago, Adrian, I'm gonna hook you up, I'm gonna send you a new one. I finally did.
Maybe we should spit in it so they can get our DNA. No. Should be like, here you go.
Also available on the Paul's Hardware store, we have bottle openers, metal, thumb screw logo, very dense. Here we have Paul's Hardware bamboo coasters, also with the classic thumb screw logo, available in sets of 4. I've also been using these for quite some time, and if you put a drink on them, it will hold the drink a good, you know, like almost a centimeter up higher than it was before.
Oh, that's how it works? Oh, cool.
So that's our supplemental merch, and now we have like clothing wearing stuff. And this is actually officially for Joe. Look, Joe, it's your first official Paul's Hardware thing.
For like a week, and then the girlfriend takes it.
I hope your girlfriend doesn't take this one too. She's not allowed. This is a pullover hoodie. It's got the thumb screw logo, kind of a distressed look right there. So here, you wanna try that on? Give it a whirl.
What's with the girls taking like their hoodies? Seriously. Cool, I'm sure my girlfriend will like this.
All right, product number one there for Joe. We've also got a set of these shirts. These are the 3x3 logo shirts. They got all the parts, all the 8-bit parts to build a computer. The computer itself, the thumb screw, motherboard, memory, all those good things. Quite a few of those. We got that available in black as well as gray. So there's a look at the gray one. These 8-bit logos we came out with last year, and I've only used them like a little bit. I've had intentions and plans of using them more and making some more designs with them. Here's a shirt that Joe wanted. This is the, what is this? Hot sauce color. Heather, it's like a burnt orange, I think. So there's Joe's first official Paul's Hardware thumb screw logo. But Joe doesn't like, he's like Einstein. He devotes so much time to thinking about the edits. He doesn't want to think about what to wear in the morning. So he got 3 of the same color.
Well, I don't know if you noticed in like the videos, I always wear like the same shirt just because people always point that out because it's, I don't know, people are anal about that kind of stuff. So just wear the same shirt.
You got to give the fans what they want. Thumbscrew logo in black. We got some more classic Thumbscrew logo shirts. We got the gray finish. I really like the gray finish one too. That one's really soft. We also have a dark gray. And my brain is telling me over and over again, this is taking way too long. I've been wanting one of these. I've got the RGB PC design. This is the just graphics card design. This is the RGB PC design on a zip-up hoodie. Oh, look at that. Beautiful, perfect, I love it. All right, here is the new design. We'll get a close-up of this too. But actually, John came up with this design. We did a couple tweaks to it. It's the black and white versions of all those 8-bit logos, sort of in a bit of a waterfall. So from top to bottom, going big to small, pretty cool new layout for that. And that's available in zip up and pullover hoodies. So we got a couple of those on hand so I can start wearing them. And that's it, guys. Big box of merch that showed up. I just wanted to take it all out of the box, and I figured I might as well point a camera at it and share it with you guys, especially since some of it was for Joe, and I'm very glad that we could finally get Joe outfitted with some Paul's Hardware merchandise. Links to my store is down in the description, paulshardware.net. And yeah, I'm gonna start, I gotta wash this hoodie so I can start wearing it ASAP. Fantastic and glorious. I'm very glad that I finally made good on some of my promises to get some people some merch. And Joe, I'm sorry I wasn't sure of this when we unboxed all those, because I had a list of things and I was trying to make sure I organized things, but you get one of these too. Here, Paul's Hardware pint glass. Very careful, very careful.
Even though I don't drink no more.
It doesn't have to hold alcohol, it can hold other things too.
Oh really?
Yeah. Very versatile, the Paul's Hardware pint glasses. But guys, one last time, paulshardware.net if you wanna check out my merch store. Again, there's a sale going on through the end of the year, so it's a great way to get merch, save some money, help support the channel, and check out the new designs like this one I've got here and I'm wearing so proudly. Thank you guys all for sending in your questions as well. That's gonna be the last Probing Paul for 2023. If you would like to ask me questions in the future, next year, 2024, leave them in the comment section below. Also, hit the thumbs up button on this video if you liked it. Subscribe to my channel if you're not already. We'll see you all in the next video.